So the field of psychology has recently run into some problems. Maybe you've heard about some failed replications over the past few years. One big program called the Reproducibility Project tried to replicate 100 different famous effects in psychology with 100 different research teams. They reported that only 39 of those studies replicated the original result. Or perhaps you saw some headlines singling out some other famous effects, like a series of replications related to self-control. Psychologists thought that if you had to make too many choices that exercise your self-control, you'd wear it out like a muscle and start making bad decisions. The replications didn't quite work out that way. After seeing all this, you might start to wonder, can psychology be trusted? Is this even a science, or are people just making stuff up? Hopefully I can convince you to not be too nervous about the state of the science. But psychology and other social sciences face some challenges that more physical sciences don't, which can make it a lot harder to do science well. To start with, humans are complicated systems, and their behavior can be hard to measure. Compare it to something more concrete. Imagine I'm a physiologist with a simple hypothesis that height and weight are correlated. Makes sense. If you're 6 feet tall, then you need more stuff to fill up those 6 feet than if you're only 5 feet tall. So I get a tape measure, a bathroom scale, and 100 people, and then I measure everyone's height and weight and find a correlation. Now let's compare it to a hypothesis in psychology. Let's say you want to test the hypothesis that self-esteem is correlated with intelligence. But unlike a person's height, which is a physical thing you can see, self-esteem is what you call a hypothetical construct. We can't see it or measure it directly, but we can ask you questions we think are related to it, like how much you agree or disagree with a series of statements. When you get a score on a survey like that, that's not your actual self-esteem, that's just an approximation called an operational definition. So your survey score is related to this unobserved, unknowable, hypothetical construct of self-esteem, but it's not a perfect relationship. Same with measuring your intelligence. Your score on an intelligence test is related, but not identical to your actual hypothetical intelligence. What this means is that even if the pure hypothetical constructs are related just as much as height and weight, your observed measurements might be correlated much less, because you're actually observing a relationship that crosses three invisible paths instead of just one. Just because psychologists are interested in things that are hard to measure, we're going to be working with much smaller effects than physical scientists. And that's just how hard it is to measure us, let alone whether the things we're measuring are any less predictable than, say, a chemical reaction or a rocket's trajectory. Small effects like this are harder to detect, and that means it's much more important to be able to replicate your results. Truth is replicability, but replications also bring complications. For example, when you run a study, you can get an estimate of how big the effect is, along with a confidence interval representing how sure you are of that effect's size. If zero falls within that range, then you don't have evidence for the effect. This can present a problem. What if you run a replication of a successful study, but find that the effect is smaller? The original effect was outside the confidence interval of the replication, but the replication was still different from zero. According to the standards set by the Reproducibility Project, who tried to replicate 100 studies and only found 39 that worked, that counted as a failed replication. And this situation turned out to happen quite a bit, because the replications tended to have more people participating, making the confidence intervals smaller. Some argue it's better to refer to this as an inconclusive replication, but not failed. Plus, it's always possible that subtle differences in the replication can change the outcome. One high-profile replication tested the facial feedback hypothesis, that the shape of your face can influence the emotion you're feeling, even if you're not explicitly expressing that emotion. The original study found that people with a pen forcing their face into a smile found cartoons funnier than people who had to purse their lips. A replication project involving 17 different labs couldn't reproduce the effect. But they filmed the participants, which wasn't done in the original study, and they held the pen in their mouths in a slightly different way. Another example was a replication of an effect called ego depletion. The idea was if you had to make a lot of choices that exercise self-control, you could lose that ability to control yourself.
I feel like you can only do so many things you don't want to do before you just accidentally eat a whole ice cream cake.
A major replication project across 23 different labs tried to find this effect and they couldn't. They said if there's any ego depletion effect, it's close to zero. But the task they used to wear people out was something called a go-no-go task. People click a button when they see a word with a letter E, but not when the E is within two letters of another vowel. So when people see an E, they have the impulse to click, but they have to suddenly catch themselves if they see another vowel nearby. That sudden stopping is definitely a kind of self-control, but it's not the same as doing something you don't want to do, like not eating a cake that's in front of you or bottling up an emotion. Both of which have been used in previous studies that found an ego depletion effect. I'm not trying to dismiss these replications. They're absolutely valuable and a critical element of scientific understanding. But it's possible that what they're telling us are the limits or boundary conditions of an effect, or that the effect is much smaller than we thought it was, but not necessarily that it was always a fiction. Given this possibility, psychologists and the media who cover them may want to be a bit more reserved when describing the effects they found. So the sky isn't falling, but that doesn't mean everything's all roses either. Some studies were revealed to be false positives from the start, or completely fabricated data. How did they get through peer review? And is there any way we can prevent that? That'll be the topic next time. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you then. I'm not trying to This can present a problem.